Stories on Edgemont. I'll say it one more time. Welcome, welcome, welcome to everybody to our community stories on Edgemont. We are so glad to have you here. And please, if you have a moment, please comment in the chats from where you're watching this from. We really appreciate it. Today's story is on Edgemont and is sponsored by Neighborhood Improvement Services, working on equitable community engagement. We believe that Durham strongly stands on everyone has a story worth being told, and that communities are all based on those stories. So we have decided to collect as many stories as we possibly can. And today's story is dedicated to the Edgemont community. We have two amazing speakers with me today. I am your facilitator, Miles Spann, and we have two amazing speakers, Mr. Charlie Gibbs, who is a longtime resident of the community, and Miss Alice Cheek, who is a current resident of the neighborhood right now. Please say hello. Say hello, Miss Cheek. Are you there?
Yes. Hello.
Hello, hello, that's Miss Cheek. And Mr. Gibbs, could you please say hello to the audience?
Hey, everybody.
Wonderful. We are so appreciative of you all being here today with us. So we are going to start from the very top. This is the area. So please, either Mr. Gibbs or Ms. Cheek, could you tell us what we're looking at, where we are on the map? I know it may be a little bit difficult, but can you explain where Edgemont is?
Where is it? Right there. It's in the center. Edgemont is in the center of Main Street and downtown area and the resident area. That's Edgemont.
Wonderful. Wonderful. So, Ms. Cheek, would you start us off? Could you paint us a picture? What time period? When did you live in Edgemont, or where were you around that time? And where are we? What's going on at that time? Specifically, I know you were in Hayti. So tell us a little bit about
it. Well, I was in Hayti when I was growing up. But I came from Fruit Gardens and moved over into Edgemont. Mm-hmm. Where I came from. Mm-hmm. And that was back in, I can't remember that far back. But I've been in my home over 30 years.
Yes. So Ms. Cheek is a current resident of Edgemont. And Mr. Gibbs, tell us about your connection to Edgemont.
Well, I have a pretty deep connection. I was born there in 1942. And I was born across the street from the church. And of all things, the last house that was torn down in that area was for the rescue mission to, they did use the house for male residents. But at any rate, 1942, that was a long time ago. And up at the top left, you can see that's my brother and my sister holding me as a baby. And below them is my daddy and my younger sister. And that was, well, you can imagine what year it was. If I was born in 42, that was probably 43, 4. Can I comment on what's going on here?
Or, sure, please.
Well, this and the one, a slide previous to that is more of a close-up of the church. This was the day that there was a split in the church, and it was over beliefs, differences, and I'll just say beliefs. But anyway, this is the Sunday morning that they walked out and went over to their new church, where they were going to build a new church on Trinity, not Trinity, Liberty Street, which is, of all things, the name of the new church, Liberty Street Free Will Baptist Church. And of all things, I have a relative in there, but that's irrelevant. That happened in the 60s. Yeah, this is a closer up view of the same thing. And the church itself was probably one of the more unique designs in Durham at that time, sort of a pseudo-Gothic revival. And the group of men over to the left, that picture was taken probably about 1944. It shows the pastor at the time, Henry Melvin. My daddy is in the middle, Leonard Gibbs. I could identify some more, but that's and I'm hoping the children of some of these guys who will listen to this at some point. But anyway, go on Preservation Durham and you can see a whole bunch of stuff and a lot of my verbiage. But it was a very interesting time. I was probably 15, 16 when this walkout occurred. Mm-hmm. I stayed with the church because my mother and grandmother and aunt were charter members there.
Yeah. Mr. Gibbs, could you tell us, for the audience, could you tell us what was happening at that time and what was the makeup of Edgemont?
Well, Edgemont at this time and even back to when I was a baby, growing up, when I got a little bit older, Edgemont was, a working class neighborhood, and I could safely say that because most of the people worked at the mill, and that, well, that's just the way things evolved from the very beginning. They worked at Golden Belt, and I don't know, it was a close mixed-use development, and that's a modern description of what it was. There were churches, gas stations, grocery stores, the fish market, and businesses up Main Street all the way to the railroad tracks, which when you crossed it, you were in downtown Durham, I guess you could say. Mm-hmm. But from the railroad tracks east, that was Edgemont. It was a fun place to grow up in, no doubt about it. A lot of things happened, and there are details that are not worth going into right now. But you can see in this picture, there was a ball field. That was an area that, you know, we all went there to play. And the business district is in the foreground, from one end, from Austin Avenue on up to the railroad tracks, which is where Fayetteville Street is now. And of course, I'm pointing at it, but you can't see that. At the middle left is where the original mill, knitting mill was located. And just as an aside, since I mentioned 1942, that mill had several uses during the war. And I remember sitting on the steps as a toddler and watching the army trucks pulling a load of soldiers, and there may be one pulling a big gun. And that mill at one point served as an armory. I can recall seeing soldiers out there sort of in a bivouac before they were shipped out. That's just my memories of World War II there. Mm-hmm. I could go on and on, but that's basically what it is.
Right.
It was a good place to live. Everything you needed was right in the neighborhood within walking distance, mm-hmm. which is what we're striving for today in our developments. But, and that mill actually was not the first mill. The first one was built in East Durham at the end of Driver Street. And this is something that I ran across in a historical account. But anybody that's familiar with East Durham will notice the resemblance on a smaller scale of its being a community that is, everything you need is right there. It's a small, compact community. And it's that's what Edgemont was.
Mm-hmm.
And it was very similar to Hayti. They had everything they needed.
Yeah.
And that's all I'll say right now.
Thank you so much, Mr. Gibbs. Miss Cheek,
yes.
Tell me, so where were you when you were growing up in Hayti? Tell me the makeup and like what you remember about even your interactions with Edgemont while you were at Hayti.
I've grown up, I was a young girl growing up in Hayti. We stayed on Branch Place. That was the name of the street we stayed on.
Mm-hmm.
And we had, like he said, we had everything that we needed in our development too.
Mm-hmm.
Cause we weren't allowed to walk across the railroad track. So everything was built in one community. Whatever we needed was in our community too. Like funeral homes, grocery stores, shoe shine boy. We used to have a ink place that did all our Black history papers downtown, on Grant's Place. We had all of that down in our little community. East Durham, like I said before, we wasn't allowed in East Durham. So I couldn't give you nothing about East Durham back during that time.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Were you there during the walkouts that Mr. Gibbs mentioned before?
No, I wasn't there.
Okay. So it was very little intermingling. So tell me, you told me a really good story about your favorite memory from growing up downtown. And it was on a paycheck day. Would you like to share that story?
Yes, sir. It was a paycheck Friday, no paycheck day. My father used to work at Jack Tar Hotel in the blue light room. And I used to go down there, and me and my girls, I call them my friend girls, we used to go down there, and we used to eat. And when we came out of there, we were fatter than a fat. We were full with a free meal. Free meal makes full. And my daddy used to get my little money on Friday and go down there to Woodward or Cresses or Sears or somewhere and spend it. So yeah, those was the good old days.
Yes. So tell me, you were telling me about how different downtown was. How different was it?
Well, you know, just going back downtown, downtown was like a family community. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Because they had a place where you could go borrow money when you didn't have money. And everybody was treated the same. Downtown was like a family, you know? But when we went in different stores, we had to go in the back of the door, like Rayleigh's and Rose's. We had to go in the back. We couldn't go in the front. And Cress's, we had to go in the back of those stores as we was growing up. My mother and I, my siblings, we used to walk across the railroad track to come downtown. That's how close downtown was to Brent's place.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but that was the good old days. It was just good memories, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You could knock on Miss Jones' door and Miss Jones would feed you. Miss Jones seen you out there fighting and having this fight with your siblings. Miss Jones would whoop you and then tell your mama. that's what the community was all about, you know. That's what it was down back during that time as I was growing up in Hayti.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Miss Cheek. Mr. Gibbs, could you tell me a little bit about your favorite story? You talked about music down at near Hayti.
Oh gosh, yes. But I want to reiterate what Ms. Cheek has said. Downtown was alive. There was something going on. Window shopping was exactly that. You could walk by and the displays in there, you didn't even have to go in. It was well lit, and it was just a place that we as kids, teenagers, adults, everybody would go downtown, and it's everybody got along with everybody. It was just a good time, much different from now.
Yeah.
But speaking of downtown, every Saturday, Daddy would take me to a movie. If it was a Rocky Lane or Lash LaRue movie, Daddy, we got to go to the Rialto. It was the Rialto and the Uptown, which was the closest ones on Main Street to Roxburgh Street, and go down the hill at Roxburgh Street to Pettigrew Street, turn left and go to Hayti. It's not very far at all. We'd go to the movie, and we came out. Some of the people, the guys mostly, had come up from the Hayti, the Main Street district there, and playing or standing on the corner, harmonizing. There were people, a few of them had guitars, and they were playing what I call loose string guitar blues. The harmonizing was true jazz. Mm. It came from the heart. And it was such touching, fun music, and they would usually gather at this drugstore that was next door to the Uptown Theater, and inside there was a shoeshine stand, and this guy in there he can make that rag pop. If you've heard the story of Chattanooga Shoeshine Boy, if anybody has ever heard it, it's but he could really make it pop in rhythm. It made you want to have your shoes shine, whether it needed it or not. But that music followed me. I can still hear some of it. But that's what made downtown unique in those days. I was only about 11 years old at that time. You do the math. I can't think right now. Born in 42 and as 11, is in the 40s. But that's what gave downtown Durham and Edgemont and their interconnections and Hayti the character of it. It was honest.
Yeah.
So I
do want to be clear. At this point in time, was Durham still, was the community still segregated?
Yes. Of course it was. And Ms. Cheek alluded to that. I recall that people said from the Hayti area, I think they had to get permission to cross the tracks.
Yes.
Which always seemed to be, even at that time, as a kid, that's ridiculous. Mm-hmm. But that's, it was segregated, but there were those of us who had relationships. Mm-hmm. If it may not have been deep relationships, but there was some respect,
mm-hmm.
I would guess, or just getting to know the few people that I knew. And that's the answer to what's going on today. I wish it could go, well, in a way, I wish it could go back to that, but not to the point where the Black community was held under a thumb. We're freer now, and we can voluntarily interact, which gets it to what Edgemont, the potential of Edgemont was.
Right. So you told us a story about your friend Norman. Can you tell us about Norman?
And I'm going to say his whole name, Norman Peaks, in case anybody that's that knows him or knows his family, this name will ring a bell. But we worked for this builder, and we became friends, and he was a little older than I. And we were doing some work near downtown. I don't recall what it was. We were doing carpentry work all over the place. So he said, let's get some lunch and go get a hot dog in the hotel. Or there was a cafe down the first floor of the hotel. And I wondered about that. But we went in, and I was the only white face in there. And but I felt safe. Everybody was nice. And this was when I was an early teenager, 14, maybe. So that's that was my first realization of that, and Norman and my conversations on roofs and whatever we were doing. But that was my first taste of it. Mm-hmm. There was another, there used to be hops dances down at the Armory, which is across the street from the hotel downtown. He said, why don't you come up to the hotel, come up to the Armory, to the hop. Well, that was, the hop was only for blacks. And I and a few of my friends went down there, and we could only access the balcony. That was another realization of reversed, a reversal of the way things were in those days. We were up there watching the fun downstairs, and we couldn't join in. So that led to more of my understanding of racial issues. But Norman and I were still friends.
Good. Thank you so much, Mr. Gibbs. Ms. Cheek, you had a story about King Kong. You tell me about King Kong.
I was sitting here and I would listen to Mr. Gibbs talk, and memories start going in my head, and I'm going to get to the King Kong story. But I remember when my uncle, his name was Hambone, and my uncle Sammy Dewar used to stand in front of the grocery store that on Branch Place and used to do Hambone.
Yes.
And Ken sitting down there, and my uncle Sammy Dewar used to tap dance. So they got so famous, they moved to New Jersey and tap dancing and making, went famous up there tap dancing. So yeah, I said my uncles and them, they used to stand right in front of between Skippy Scarborough Funeral Home and a grocery store, Bird's grocery store. Thank you, Jesus. See, all this memory coming back with the Bird's grocery store. And my uncle and my two uncles used to tap dance, and the other one made up the song Hambone, Hambone, Have You Heard? Mama gonna buy you a mockingbird. And he used to do all that crisscross stuff and had a little can down there. They would drop little chain down. Thank you, Mr. Gibbs, for bringing back my memories.
Oh, yeah. I remember Hamboning.
Yeah. So he brought up that he was down at the restaurant. He was the only white. Well, man, I would take my kids to the theater on Sundays because I would have the weekend off on my job. And so I heard that King Kong was playing at the Carolina Theater. So I took me and my three kids, we went to Carolina Theater, and we was the only blacks in there, and we wasn't treated no different. When the lights went out, we all were dark. The lights came on, we all were light. So that was the good thing about it. We all was treated the same. So yeah, like I said, Durham is my hometown. I was brought up in Durham, and I remember so much of joy and how when we was able to come together, how we didn't treat no one different. It was just the joy of all of us coming together. And then when my memory got to clicking again, when we couldn't cross the railroad track, but we had a train used to come on Branch Place and used to drop off veggies. And we used to climb over the train to get to the dock to get the free veggies. I remember that. I don't know if Mr. Gill remember that, but I remember that. And I we would go back home and we would have apples and oranges and stuff. But yeah, those was one of the good days, how all of us came together in a community and we did things with one another.
Mm. Yeah. Yes, that is so good.
And if you wanted to cross the railroad track where downtown, main downtown, see, we could go downtown, but it was a limitation where downtown. time we, and when you got down by East Durham, and it was a railroad track, if you crossed the railroad track, you would get beat up because you was out of your district. We wasn't allowed to cross the railroad track. Just like they weren't allowed to come on our side, we wasn't allowed to come on their side.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. So Ms. Cheek, how long, so you lived in Haiti. So tell me, give me, where did you move after you left Haiti?
Well, at that time I was living with my mother and we moved to Peachtree Alley, called Peachtree Alley. And that was right on the opposite side of where Liberty Street is at now. Mm-hmm. And it was like, it was a black neighborhood. Mm-hmm. It was a black neighborhood and we had, but we had a couple of others that would come over into our neighborhood and we didn't treat them no different than we were. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then when we left Peachtree Alley, we moved to Plum Street because my mother used to work at the tobacco factory. Well, I forgot the name of the factory. On Plum Street, my mother used to work there at that tobacco factory. And we had to move because they built the bridge on Plum Street. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that was a black neighborhood. You didn't. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So it was, all I could say, out of all the years that I've been on this, been living in Durham, I have seen a lot of big changes. Uh-huh. Some for the good, thank you, Jesus, and some for the bad.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, we all gonna have to come together.
Amen.
Yes. Mr. Gibbs, tell me, so how long did you stay in Edgemont? And, you know, give us a little bit about your history in that and in the community.
Well, as I said, I was born in, well, the house is gone now, in the house that was across the street, and it was the last one to be torn down for the Durham Rescue Mission expansion.
You know about when that was?
Let's see, it came down, I guess about 6 years, 5 or 6 years ago.
Oh, recent. Okay.
Yeah, rather recent. Yeah. The rescue mission used it to house, as a men's dormitory. And of course they did some renovations to it, but I can still feel myself in that house.
Yeah.
When my brother and sister would invite friends over, they would roll the rugs back in the living room. And we had an old Victrola, which none of y'all probably know what I'm talking about, but it was a crank thing. It cranked it up. And I guess it was some springs or something in there. And a big megaphone as a speaker. But at any rate, Edgemont was sort of self-sufficient as I have gone over. And like Ms. Cheek mentioned about Haiti, because, you know, everybody there, or most everybody, worked at the mill. Golden Belt. And as things progressed and people became more mobile, buying cars, utilizing the bus system, people started moving away. And it was, well, that when you lose people, that means the demise is on the way. But about that time, few gardens was being built or starting to be built. My grandma and granddaddy, who worked at Golden Belt, lived on the corner of Worth and Holman Street. And across the street, Holman was, it was just swampy land, trees, Goose Creek ran through there. And I don't know what they did with Goose Creek when they infilled it, but they started building a few gardens, and I watched it from the back steps. And that was amazing. And with the building, a few gardens, people moved in, and it was, I guess you could call it Section 8 type housing. And that sort of revitalized things. More people, more things going on. You know, people just naturally are going to upgrade the living standards. And that was a fun place to play. There was always something going on in Few Gardens. And that was in Edgemont. Edgemont went from the railroad tracks over somewhere east before you get to East Durham, over to Taylor Street, and a little beyond Angier Avenue to the trestle down there, the railroad trestle. So there were no real hard boundaries that had been surveyed with meets and bounds. It was just generally, you know, this is what we, this is where we live. We live in Edgemont. Well, the people a few houses down say, well, we live in East Durham. Yeah. It's but there's, like Miss Cheek said, things change gradually over the years, and they finally closed down the Golden Belt from making hosiery, socks, whatever. But they started making cigarette packaging or whatever for American or Liggett and Myers, and maybe it was Liggett and Myers. But at any rate, that brought it back to life a little bit. And then when that ran out, that's when the real demise of Edgemont started, and tear down a building here. The school burned down in the 60s. Late 60s, I think. And it gradually, the picture that was up a while ago were the only two, that one, that's the only thing that's left of the Main Street business district. To the left, it goes up the hill. There were a restaurant, pool hall, a drugstore, and some other things. But this building on the right, the taller one, mm-hmm. which is next to that Baptist church, upstairs to the right is where the recreation center, I guess you could call it, Saturday night dances, of course, most of the with live bands, but most of the music was country music. but anyway, that was a place where social events were held. I could go on with stories of it all, but just generally speaking, you could walk to social events, mm-hmm. walk to grocery store, walk up the hill. When you cross the railroad tracks, you were in Durham, mm-hmm. or the edge of town. And the Duke Power bus garage was on the right, just as you crossed the street. It was not like Fayetteville Street is now. It was like a dirt road. And anyway, the Duke Power bus garage was, it was a really smelly place with the diesel engines and all, because they worked on them there.
Yeah.
But I don't know of any other details on other than personal experiences.
And that is okay. That is okay. Thank you so much, Mr. Gibbs. Miss Cheek, I know you moved back. So I want you to tell me a little bit about where we are now with
Let me tell you. Right now, at the end, down here used to be the laundromat. Right there at the corner.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Then as you go up a little further, there used to be a wicker place. The man used to make wicker chairs.
Huh.
Yeah, that was in the center. And the big building that's sitting on the corner, it says, God first, little people second. It used to be a clothing store. Yeah.
Okay. Where's the fish market at?
The fish market is across the street.
You both had stories about the fish market.
I remember the fish market across the street, right across from Refined Fire Church. Mm-hmm. The fish market used to be right there on the corner.
That's great.
That's if you wanted to go get some fresh fish and fry it on Fridays and Saturdays, that's where you went.
Wonderful. So, Ms. Cheek, tell me about when you moved back. When did you move back, and when did you decide to move into Edgemont? Bring us into today.
I was staying in Frugarten, and a development came to Frugarten, and they was asking single parents, single mothers, would they want to apply for first-time home buyers. And it was Bryant South real estate that was doing that for single mothers. And I applied for it, and my application came through. So that's how I got over here in Edgemont. But let me roll back towards Frugarten first. Before I moved in Frugarten, we wasn't allowed in Frugarten, because when Frugarten was built, it was built for the others, not for us. And then back in 74 and 75, it started letting others move, it started mixing it up. Then I moved out of Frugarten, I stayed in Frugarten for 25 years. I moved out of Frugarten over into Edgemont Am's home. I have my own home. And I moved over here in 85, around 85. And I've been in my home over 30 some years.
Wonderful. How big of a deal was it for you to move into Edgemont?
Oh, it was excited to own my, I'm gonna be honest. Oh, it was excited for a Black woman, single Black mother to own her own home. It was excited to me. I struggled to keep my home.
How many jobs did you
have? I had three jobs. I had a job to pay my bills, I had a job to take care of my kids, and I had a job to feed us. Three jobs. That's how I my home is paid for now, but it was worth it.
Yeah.
It was really worth it. A lot of women, single women could never say that they had to struggle to pay for a home for their kids. But it's a struggle when you're single. So when you can pay for a home being single, it's a beautiful thing. I mean, it's a awesome thing.
Yeah, that is good. That is so good. So we're running a little low on time. I do want us to get to a Q&A section, but I have one more question for you both. If you were to say the one thing that stands out about Edgemont, whether in the past or whether now, what is it?
What stands out in Edgemont?
Mm-hmm.
Me, they took these homes that back in the day that we wasn't allowed in and rebuilt them and put us in there.
Mm-hmm. That's good.
I would go along with that too. It's the thing about Edgemont, I think, that still stands out is its self-sufficiency in spite of lots of things. And the neighbors, I guess that's about it. It's everything you needed was in walking distance. Like everything in society, it's people move on. And there, it happens so gradually, all of a sudden it's here.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. Well, thank you both so much. We're gonna take a, about 5 or 10 minutes so we can wrap up nicely. But I want to ask everybody in the audience, the participants, if you please could put any questions that you have in the Q&A section for Mr. Gibbs and Ms. Cheek, so that we can make sure they can give you a little bit more insight. Please, please, please put your questions in there and we will we'll take about 5-10 minutes to answer those questions. It looks like, Mr. Gibbs, we have a question from Eddie Davis. He's asking, do you have any memory of Edgemont native Wilbur Hobby, who became the state president of the AFL-CIO and who ran for governor of NC?
Do I have, yeah, I remember that. And hey, Eddie, I've known Eddie for many years. You do remember me, don't you? Anyway, yeah, that, and I'd like to say too, Edgemont Church, Edgemont Free Will Baptist Church, the ones that I've been sending all the information about, there was a racial issue going on. Anyway, it's been made into a movie, a book. My mind needs to be jump started. But yeah, I remember Wilbur Hobby. Yeah.
Wonderful. Thank you. It seems like we have a lot of people want you to tell us about the walk when people walked out of the church. What was going on?
There was a doctrinal disagreement between some, well, about half the church was one way and half was another. It split up into two factions. One was the Creech faction, which these people that you see on screen now, they walked away and started Liberty Free Will Baptist Church with him. And the Teasley faction, they were the original Edgemont Free Will Baptist charter members. They stayed and maintained the church until later on. I guess there wasn't enough income to maintain and keep the building, so they moved. I don't know where they moved to, out Chandler Road, I think, and established a church in the county. But that was the thing that drove me from the church. I was 16 there, and I said, I'm not going to put up with this. So I started going to another church, which my mother and grandmother did not like. But anyway, that's that. I can name some of the people that I see, but that's irrelevant. So
Mr. Gibbs, when you say doctrinal, you mean like purely religious? Because I think what people are trying to hint at is that, was it a walkout because of integration or something like that, or it had something completely to do, completely different?
Absolutely not. It had nothing to do with integration. It was doctrinal differences. Free Will Baptists have their start in the Church of England, when people wanted to meet and worship the way they wanted to, as, you know, free will. And that's how it came to this country, and that's what Free Will Baptist means. But there's, you know, when people have their beliefs and they stick to them and they ain't budging, it can cause strife. And so they just said, heck with this, we're going to somewhere else. That's basically it.
That makes sense. I have two more questions, and then we'll wrap it up for right now. And then if anybody has any additional questions, we can have it after the wrap up. What kind of games did the neighborhood kids play together?
For me?
I don't know if it's for you or Miss Cheek, but it might be both. What type of games did the neighborhood kids play together?
We would play stickball. We put a stick on the curb and use another stick to bounce it up in the air and then hit it. That was a street game. We'd go up to the park, play football, the regular stuff, swing. I didn't have a bicycle until I got older. But anyway, go ahead, Miss Cheek.
We used to play hopscotch. We used to take and put a rock on the curb, and we used to play seesaw on a board, or we would jump on the board. We would play jump rope. We would play jet rocks. We would dodgeball. We would play kickball. we played a lot in our neighborhood. Hide and go see.
Yeah.
1, 2, 3. And when I moved in Edgemont, I became the head facilitator for the city of Durham. It was an organization when it first started out. It was an organization of mothers against crime. And I joined, it was Myron Langley was the head of it. And I joined it because my future was our young kids my kids, my neighbor's kids, and everybody else's kids in the neighborhood. So that's one reason why I joined the Mothers Against Crime. Mm-hmm. To deal with the police department and all of that and them and that. So then something changed. They made me head of the facilitator of District 5. And then I was the head of National Night Out. Now, we used to have a ball at National Night Out. And if you look on your right-hand corner, that's how many people I used to serve at National Night Out, over 300 people. And we used to have all kinds of games and stuff. And if you look in the center at the top where it says Edgemont Ams apartment park, I designed that park for our kids over in the neighborhood. It was a fight, I'm telling you. It was really a fight. It took years and years for me to get this park designed for these kids. I would go to the park and I would see rusty poles and the kids was playing on them and stuff. And that brought memories of when I was young. And I said, no. You said that you was out here for the young folk, for our future. So you got to make things better for our future.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I fought hard for that park. So I designed that park with Durham Parks and Recs. Every time the city council board had a meeting, I was there. No one else in the neighborhood was there, but I was there. I remember when Chief Lopez came on. I remember when Chief Davis came on. I just remember a lot. I've been working with the city for so long that I remember people coming in and going out.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm telling you, I enjoy doing what I did for the kids in the neighborhood. Not only our neighborhood, we would have kids from Liberty Street, Lovely Square, the New Fruit Gardens. They thought that they would come, they were part of our neighborhood. And when I had it, they always, the kids were so happy. And when the kids was happy, I was happy. And my main thing that I'm gonna end you with is I did it for the elderly people too in the hosiery mill.
Yes. Thank you. So
I used to sell ices, and everybody asked me, how did you get the money to have such a big National Night Out? Well, National Night Out is an organization that you can't take money. And Refiner's Fire donated stuff. They would come out and help me. Ernie Mill would come out and help me. And I would sell ices, the little icy cups. I need to show you one. I got some still here. I sold ices. And that's how I got all my money up to make sure that the kids had ices. I used to sell sweet potato cakes. I used to sell pickles. I used to sell chips because I wanted these kids to have something to remember.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much, Ms. Cheek and Mr. Gibbs. I just want to say thank you all for everyone who attended. We're going to close out for today, and I'm going to pass it to Laura so she can do the outro. And we will take a couple more seconds afterwards so that we can answer any additional questions for just like 5 minutes or so. But Laura, please go ahead, bring us out.